In just a moment, Autolite presents Suspense with John Garfield.
Hello, Mr. Wilcox.
Well, hello, Mary. Where's Hap tonight? Anaheim, Azusa, or Cucamonga?
Oh, no, Mr. Wilcox. He's giving a speech at his club tonight. And he was scared to death, too. Didn't know what to talk about.
Well, why doesn't he talk about those bang-up, bonus-built Autolite stay-full batteries? Why, by Cornelius, he could talk a whole evening about them. For Autolite stay-full batteries have got something that practically eliminates a major cause of battery failure. You know what it is?
Why, sure, they have...
No. Now, please, don't steal my thunder, Mary. Oh. Autolite stay-full batteries have an extra-large liquid reserve, which means, in plain old Wilcox language, that Autolite stay-full batteries need water only 3 times a year in normal car use. Why, by Cornelius, everybody ought to get an Autolite stay-full battery. They'd be enthralled, enthused, and thrilled.
Enthralled? Oh, no, Mr. Wilcox, but shh, here comes Suspense.
Suspense. Autolite and its 60,000 dealers and service stations bring you radio's outstanding theater of thrills. Starring tonight, Mr. John Garfield in Anton Leder's production of Death Sentence, a tale well calculated to keep you in suspense.
It's hard to tell where it first started. It was 6 months ago that I nabbed a killer, Maxie Dunn, and cashed in $15,000 in reward money. Sure, I knew that Maxie worked for Lou Cromwell, but the killing was a private affair, so I didn't think Lou would be upset. Right after I got the killer, I took a small job that meant going to Brazil. But the trouble started before then. By the time Maxie Dunn was arrested, the chips were down and the wheel was already spinning. Anyway, that's how Lou Cromwell would put it, and Lou would know because he knows his gambling. He runs the gambling in this town, along with a lot of other things. I hadn't been back in town 10 minutes when I ran into Brad Cummings, local columnist, in front of the Region Hotel.
Well, 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 you're back in town. How are you, Tommy?
Hello, Brad. How's the column?
Oh, great, great. Don't even have to write it anymore. I'm reusing last year's stuff. Say, Tommy, I'm just going to a cocktail party in the hotel. Come along.
Whose party?
Lou Cromwell's.
Say, he'll be surprised to see me.
Oh, he'll love it, Tommy. Come on.
Okay, let's go to your party.
Hiya, Tommy Johnson. Hiya, Tommy.
Hiya, Tommy.
What do you say, fella? What do you know?
Well, it doesn't look like Lou's shown up yet.
Well, what's he celebrating?
Well, he hasn't said yet. Say, why'd you come back, Tommy?
Why shouldn't I? It's a nice town.
Sure, except when Lou Cromwell doesn't want it to be.
Meaning?
Oh, nothing much. I'm only a columnist, Tommy. And like I said, I'm using last year's news, so I'm still interested in Maxie Dunn.
Oh, it's a dull story, Brad. The cops couldn't find Maxie, so the widow of the guy he killed hired me. I dug up a tip on Maxie's hideout and brought him in. There happened to be a 15 grand reward, so I had myself a custom-built vacation. I guess I was just born lucky.
Lou may think you ought to die the same way.
Well, I can take care of myself. Besides, why should Lou worry about it one way or the other?
Well, you have done some work for him.
Well, sure, sure. I'm a private investigator. I work for anybody who'll pay me as long as the job's on the level. And those I did for Lou were, too.
You don't have to argue with me, Tommy. But I told you a year ago not to get mixed up with Lou. A man has to pick one side of the fence and stay there. He can't play on both sides.
I don't know, Brad. I've done pretty well at it.
Until now. But Maxie was Lou's right hand, so I don't think he liked it.
So he didn't like it. In the meantime, I'll...
Tommy!
Oh, yeah. Oh, hello there, Muggsy.
Tommy, Lou wants to see you.
Lou? Well, how did he know... Okay, never mind. Where is he?
Not here. He wants to see you across the street. In his office.
Oh. Well, let's go. Back in a few minutes, Brad. Have a drink for me.
Sure, Tommy, sure. I'll drink to your health.
How are you, Lou?
Hello, Tommy. Nice to have you back with us.
Nice to be back, Lou. Seems to me you heard pretty fast about me being in town.
You know how it is, Tommy. People drop in here and gossip, and I hear things. Sit down.
Thanks.
Cigarette?
Sure.
Have a nice vacation?
Good enough.
I guess you're just naturally lucky, Tommy. A long vacation and 15 grand to spend. Now me? I didn't get a vacation. I had to work pretty hard, and it cost plenty trying to save Maxie Dunn. And now it's very inconvenient finding someone to take his place.
Well, if you're offering me the job, I'm not interested.
I'm glad to see you haven't changed. But seriously, Tommy, you shouldn't have turned Maxie in.
Oh, I'm sorry I inconvenienced you.
No, it's not only that. You know how it is in this racket. Either you keep rolling sevens and stay on top, or you're on the bottom. It don't look so good for me to let one of my boys take a rap.
He had it coming.
Possibly. Maxie was dumb to pull that personal job. But if I let you come in and grab off my boys, somebody will start thinking that Lou Cromwell is slipping.
Never thought of that, Lou. What's the pitch?
Let's see. Maxie goes to the gas chamber in 7 days. That's just how long you have to live, Tommy.
What? Lou, you're punchy.
Maybe. But you and Maxie are going out together.
Now, look.
You've got 7 days, Tommy. No more. You can take care of the job yourself then, or we'll handle it for you when the time's up. Play it your own way.
I could get the DA in my corner.
I don't think so, Tommy. You and I have just had a friendly talk. Nobody's made any threats. Besides, you won't win playing that way.
Maybe. And maybe there are other ways to play.
Not this time. You know, I like you, Tommy. Ordinarily, I'd even like to see you win. But once in a while, the house has to rake in a few chips to stay in business.
Yeah, but you better tell the house man to keep his foot off the brake. I'm playing to win, Lou.
I knew you would. That makes it more interesting. I get tired of playing with plain suckers. Well, I got a party across the street. Care to come along?
I've already been there. It's not much of a party.
It'll get better. I'll see you around, Tommy. Don't start brooding about the 7 days. Make the most of them. Oh, you need any money?
No, thanks. I'll make out all right.
Good. Go out and have some fun. It's a great life, Tommy. As long as it lasts.
For Suspense, Autolite is bringing you Mr. John Garfield in radio's outstanding theater of thrills, Suspense.
Say, Mary, let me tell you about a most wonderful experience I had this afternoon.
Why, sure, Mr. Wilcox.
Well, I drove my car into a nearby service station, and the attendant, new man, you see, he said, check your battery, mister. Well, by Cornelius, this is the chance I've been waiting for ever since my grandfather traded his horse for a Stanley steamer.
Dear.
Young man, I says, that gorgeous hunk of battery you're looking at is an Autolite Stayfull. Why, that Autolite Stayfull battery hasn't needed a drop of water for months. And I'll bet you a $40 fedora it doesn't need water now any more than a goldfish needs a raincoat.
Did he take your bet, Mr. Wilcox?
I should say not. Bub, he says to me, you can't trick me. I'm an Autolite dealer. Why, I'd rather bet a barrel of bucks on a three-legged horse than bet an Autolite Stayfull battery needs water. What's more, says he, that Autolite battery is built to last longer than batteries without Stayfull features. It's got oversized electrical capacity, plus fiberglass insulation, and it's one of over 400 automotive, aviation, and marine parts made by the Autolite people in their 26 nationwide plants. Chew on that a while, mister.
My.
He says to me, imagine the nerve of this guy, Mary, stealing my sales talk. Me, Harlow, A for Autolite Wilcox.
Well, you just go feel sorry for yourself, Mr. Wilcox, while I listen to Suspense.
And now, Autolite brings back to a Hollywood soundstage Mr. John Garfield as Tommy Cochran in Death Sentence, a tale well calculated to keep you in suspense.
Seven more days to live. I wouldn't admit it to Lou, maybe not even to myself, but it was almost that simple. Sure, I could go to the police, but I didn't have any proof that Lou was out to kill me. And I knew that sooner or later, no matter where I went, one of Lou's boys would catch up with me. As I rode down in the elevator, I kept remembering one of Lou's gang who turned state's evidence once and got off with 3 years. 10 days after the guy checked into the big house, he was knifed to death in the prison yard. And they never found out who did it. That's the way Lou operated. Patient, deadly. Well, there wasn't any point of making plans with a guy like that. I'd pretend to follow his advice about having a good time. All I could do was keep on my toes and watch for an opening.
Main floor, sir. This is as far as we go.
Hmm? Oh, thanks. It's about as far as I go, too. I didn't know just where I was going for the first stop. But sometimes it's better if you just play it off the cuff. I guess I was still thinking of the next spin of the wheel as I walked out of the building. I didn't even notice the taxi standing at the curb or the...
Hey, why don't you look where you're going?
I'm sorry. I hope I didn't hurt your traveling case.
No, but I thought you were going to stumble right off the curb.
I guess I was thinking... Say...
What?
You're beautiful.
Well...
I hope you'll live forever.
Thanks, I'll try to.
Yeah, if you find out how, let me know, will you? Where you going?
Huh? Well, now, really?
No, I mean the traveling case there.
Oh, to Santa Barbara.
Santa Barbara, huh? Well, that's not a bad idea. Tell me something. If you had just 1 week, where would you go?
Well, I do have about a week, and I'm still going to Santa Barbara.
All right, honey. Thanks for the idea. Maybe I'll run into you again.
You must...
Hey, that guy bothering you.
Oh, hello, Muggsy. Look, will you be a darling and help me bring these bags up to Lou's office?
I threw a few things into a bag and headed for Santa Barbara. Seemed like a good place to wait for that opening. Lou would never think of me going to a pleasure resort so near. Anyway, 3 hours after I left Lou's office, I was on a plane bound for Frisco. That's right, San Francisco. When I got there, I rode around for an hour and a half in three different taxis, then caught another plane out for Salt Lake. From there, I swung back to Santa Barbara, checked in at the Swank Ocean Club Hotel. I was pretty sure I'd shaken anybody who may have been watching me. I could count on maybe 2 days before Lou's boys caught up with me, and by that time, I might have a plan. I wandered around on the beach a while, keeping my eyes open for the other reason I had picked Santa Barbara. And then, when I went inside, I saw her, sitting there at the bar. It was the same girl, and she was alone.
Well, I beg your
pardon. Hello there.
Oh, it's you. So you did come to Santa Barbara.
You told me, remember?
I only suggested that...
Yeah, I know, I'm kidding. Mind if I join you?
Please do.
I'm Tommy Cochran.
Tommy Cochran. Oh, hello, Tommy. My name's Helen Ludlow.
Helen, huh? Maybe it's silly, but I was feeling like a kid in the wrong schoolhouse until I saw you sitting there. I know that sounds like the usual...
No, I know what you mean. In fact, I felt the same way.
Good. So now we're both happy.
I guess we are. Are you here on vacation?
Not exactly. I retired yesterday. What about you?
I guess I retired, too, in a way.
I've seen you somewhere, Helen, but I just can't remember...
Probably in a show. I'm a dancer.
Sure, that's it. In Top of the Roof, last fall...
Bad guess. That was my kid sister. She had a second lead in it. I'm strictly chorus.
Strictly chorus? Mm. Well, you need a new manager. How about having dinner with me tonight and we'll talk about your career?
Well, I don't know if... All right.
Good, it's a date.
Look, Tommy, we met each other entirely by accident, but suddenly we're friends. I mean, really friends. At least, I feel that way.
Yeah, I know what you mean. Go on, Helen.
But we don't know anything about each other, and that's the way it's got to be. I won't ask any questions, Tommy, and I can't answer any. If we keep it like that, then maybe everything will be all right.
Okay, it's a deal.
I don't even know why I feel this way.
Tell me if you find out.
After all, I'm not a kid 16 years old. It just doesn't make sense.
Yeah. Well, I've known a couple of girls myself.
What are you doing this afternoon, Tommy? Would you like to go horseback riding?
Horse? Why, sure, why not? I've never been on a horse, though, but you can always pick me up.
Then it's a date.
Sure. How would you like a drink first?
That's a wonderful idea.
A drink to the present. No past, no future. So Helen and I rode horseback in the afternoon, had dinner together, and then danced until early morning. It was great, except that it's hard to be with a girl like that and not talk about the future. I wanted her in my future, only I didn't have any. Maybe she sensed it. I hadn't seen any of Lou's boys. I kept looking around, trying to spot them, thinking maybe the guy next to me might even be the one. I kept trying to forget them, And it wasn't too hard with Helen around. She was someone I'd been looking for all my life. And now maybe I'd found her too late. Every minute had to count. And I was still waiting for an opening. I got up early the next morning. Helen and I were going riding before breakfast. And for once, I wasn't thinking about Lou and his boys until I walked across the lobby of the hotel.
Hello, Tommy.
Huh?
How are you?
Well, hello, Lou.
Keeping awfully late hours, Tommy? Or else you're up early?
Maybe a little of both. What are you doing here, Lou?
Checking in. I just got off the plane. But don't let it bother you, Tommy. You still have 4 days left. By the way, what room are you in?
425.
Now, that's coincidence. They gave me 427. You can knock on the wall whenever you get lonesome.
I won't get that lonesome, Lou.
Well, you never know. Anyway, let's not talk shop. Why not enjoy ourselves? While we can.
All right, why not? They tell me it's fatal to worry. I didn't see him again that day. Helen and I took that ride, went swimming in the afternoon, and then drove down the beach for dinner. The next day was about the same, except we ended up at the hotel for dinner and dancing, of course. Funny, I'd never cared much about dancing before.
You know, you're very good at it, Tommy. Even terrific.
Dancing?
Uh-huh.
Oh, I used to be a gigolo.
Tommy, did you really?
Yeah, no, I'm kidding, Helen. I've been a lot of things, though.
Yes, so have I.
Anything besides wonderful?
Everything but that. Things have been rough sometimes.
It's that kind of a world. It may not look it in a place like this. Soft lights and white tablecloths. Nice clean people eating nice clean food. But down underneath, it's still rough.
You can forget it, though. While the music keeps on playing.
Yeah. How long are you planning to stay in Santa Barbara, Helen?
About a week. You?
A week? Why'd you come?
I can't tell you. And please don't ask me any questions, remember? Let's enjoy it while we can.
Yeah. Well, let's eat.
Oh, I wish it would last forever. I mean this week.
Maybe this is forever, honey. Here we are.
Oh, thanks, Tommy. What's this? You didn't order champagne, did you?
No, they must have made it. Oh.
I sent it over, Tommy. I thought you might like it.
Nice of you, Lou. Thanks.
Well, do I get to meet the lady, or are you starting to hold out on your old friends?
Helen, this is Lou Cromwell, Miss Ludlow.
How do you do?
You two make a lovely couple. You both seem to be having a lot of fun out there on the dance floor.
That's right, we were.
I'm glad to hear it. Have all the fun you can while you're here. Life's too short to waste any of it. Don't you think so, Tommy?
Well, 3 more days went by. I was still on my toes, but nothing had opened. I was like a fighter whose opponent wouldn't come out of his corner. I spent every minute with Helen. We weren't kidding ourselves any longer. We knew this was the biggest thing that ever happened to us. We'd both been kicked around a lot and made mistakes and played the game on a bluff, trying to get things we thought we wanted. And now we knew we had what we wanted. Only I knew how long it would keep. And there were times when I thought Helen guessed it. Maybe it was because she didn't ask any questions, as though she already knew the answers. Finally, it was nearly noon of my sixth day. I had a date for an early lunch with Helen, so I walked down the hall to her suite. I guess I was about 10 feet away when her door opened.
All right, honey. And we'll leave it that way. Just see that you deliver in 2 days.
Thanks, though. I'll try to. Tommy.
You haven't changed rooms, have you, Lou?
Tommy, it's all right. I knew Lou before I came here.
That's right, Tommy. Helen and I are old friends.
Oh? I thought I introduced you.
That was just a little idea of mine. I've got to run along now, Helen, unless Tommy has something he'd like to talk over.
No, Lou, just run along real fast.
Take it easy, Tommy. It may not make you live longer, but you'll be happier. See you around.
Would you like to come in, Tommy?
Thanks. All right, let's have it. How do you happen to know Lou Cromwell? Oh,
Tommy, doesn't everybody know Lou or know of him?
Yes, but you know him. How come?
Well, I was the dancer. I met him somewhere. You know how it is.
Yeah, I know how it is. Why didn't you tell me the other night when he sent us the wine?
He obviously didn't want me to, and I don't see how it mattered.
What did he mean before about you delivering in 2 days?
Tommy, I can't tell. Why don't you leave it that way? I can't answer questions.
You've got to, Helen. You know how I feel about you, and I thought you felt the same way.
Oh, Tommy.
It's too late now for that no-question stuff. I don't have the time. You've got to answer.
Please. Try to understand, Tommy. I came here in the first place because of Lou, because he forced me to.
What do you mean he forced you?
Because of my sister.
What are you talking
about? It's true, Tommy. She's just a crazy kid, and she got mixed up in something. Lou could make it tough for her if he wanted to. I mean really tough.
Okay, so he forced you to come here. Why?
To do something I didn't want to do, but that I had to.
What?
I can't tell you, Tommy. I didn't want to. Believe me, I have to, and that's all.
All right. All right. I believe you.
Oh, Tommy. I guess we're the kind of people who never win, no matter what.
Helen, I've done some pretty foolish things. Been around a lot.
I know what you mean.
But it's never been like this. I've never been in love with anybody before like this.
Oh, that goes for me, too.
Will you do something for me? Something important?
Why, darling?
Marry me tonight.
Tommy,
please, honey.
I don't know.
What do you say?
I never wanted anything so much. And I ought to have just one thing I want. We both ought to. All right, Tommy. Tonight.
We were married at 8 o'clock with a hotel musician playing Oh Promise Me on a pint-sized organ. And then Helen went to her suite to change for dinner. At least that's what she thought. But I had a different plan. I was going to make my own opening and take her along. Oh, I ordered the dinner all right and made a big noise about it in the dining room. And then I went straight to my room. A charter plane was already warmed up and waiting at the airfield. And I had a taxi at the rear door of the hotel. This was going to be a fast break. And I wasn't even taking any luggage. Nothing. Except Helen and me, and a .38 automatic strapped onto my coat. It was about a half hour later when I finally went down to Helen's suite to pick her up. She didn't answer, so I tried again. The door was unlocked. Helen? It's Tommy, Helen. She wasn't in the sitting room or the bedroom, so I finally opened the door to the bath. I looked around, but she wasn't in sight. Then just as I started to leave, she fell. She'd been propped up in the tub behind the shower curtain, but she fell out, hitting with a horrible limp sound. She was dead. Strangled. I stepped out and pulled the bathroom door shut, using my handkerchief to wipe off the knob without even thinking. I didn't feel anything, except maybe a numbness that still hurt. Lou had seen how I felt about her, so he'd done this, or had it done. I tried to brush the fog out of my eyes and think, but not about her lying in there, or what might have been. No, I wasn't even thinking about my 7 days. I had something else on my mind. Finally, I stepped out into the hall and started for Lou Cromwell's room. But I had only gone a few steps when I heard two guys coming, and they sounded like cops. I stepped into the hall linen closet and pulled the door shut.
Some guy calls up and says this dame was just been killed, and we'd find the killer still there. I don't know.
I got it then. Lou had not only killed Helen, he called the police and said, I did it. It didn't take long to reach his room.
Oh, it's you, Tommy. I thought it was one of the boys.
No, it's me, Lou.
I'm a little surprised at this visit, Tommy. Where's your new bride?
Why'd you do it, Lou?
Oh, you've already been there then. I thought you'd stick around longer after you found things.
So the cops would get there?
Well, something like that, maybe.
You didn't have to do it that way, Lou. Not to her.
Why'd you do it?
You mean you don't know? You should have gone back to that party with me last week.
Why?
Because then you'd have found out about my surprise, Tommy. I made the announcement that I was going to marry Helen Ludlow at the end of the week.
So? So that's what you were forcing her to do.
Oh, let's just say that I proposed and conditions were such that she accepted. When I got here, she wanted a couple of more days and I gave it to her. But today, she double-crossed me and married you. Two double-crosses. You can see the position that put me in, Tommy. It's bad for business.
Tell me, Lou, did she know about me? You know what I mean?
Yeah, she knew. I guess she thought the two of you could break the bank.
Sure,
so
Lou, you had to do it. But you made some mistakes. You made one way. What's the gun for?
Oh, I just feel more comfortable holding it this way, Tommy. Don't let it bother you, though. Go on. What were my mistakes?
One of them was not thinking I'd come here to your room and find you alone. But the big one was when you killed Helen. You shouldn't have done that.
Well, now, Tommy, don't let it get you down. Maybe I can fix it.
It's too late now. We've all had our last chance. The way you'd put it, the bets are all down. And the wheel's starting to slow up.
Well. Maybe you can tell me what number it's stopping on, Tommy.
Sure, Lou. The house takes everything.
What?
It's already stopped on 00.
Hello? Desk clerk? I'm a stranger in town. How do I find the chief of police?
Thank you, John Garfield, for a splendid performance. Mr. Garfield will return in just a moment.
Mr. Wilcox, you look all out of breath. Did suspense get you?
Me? Out of breath? Why, I only need 3 breaths a year in normal Wilcox use.
What?
I mean, Autolite Stay Full batteries need water only 3 times a year in normal car use.
My, I'm glad you got that straightened out.
Well, friends, here's something I'm really straightened out about. If you mean to make the most of your next battery buy, if you want to practically banish one cause of battery failure, then hie yourself down to your nearest Autolite dealer bright and early tomorrow morning and get your car a brand new Autolite Stay Full battery. Why, your friendly Autolite dealer will be downright delighted to put a wonderful, dependable Autolite Stay Full battery in your car. Don't delay. Get your ding-dong daisy of an Autolite Stay Full battery right away. And friends, remember, Autolite means batteries.
Stay full batteries.
Autolite means spark plugs.
Ignition engineered spark plugs.
Autolite means ignition system.
The lifeline of your car.
And now here again is Mr. John Garfield.
It's been a great pleasure to appear here tonight with this great cast of suspense actors. And I'm expecting almost as much pleasure next Thursday when radio's outstanding theater of thrills brings you Anne Blythe and Edmund O'Brien in Muddy Track, another gripping study in
suspense.
John Garfield will soon be seen starred in the Roberts production Force of Evil, presented by Enterprise Studios and released through Metro-Goldwyn-Mayer. Tonight's suspense play was written by Lou Lusty and Les Crutchfield, with music composed by Lucian Morawek and conducted by Lud Gluskin. The entire production was under the direction of Anton M. Leader. In the coming weeks, suspense will present such stars as Rosalind Russell, Agnes Moorhead, and Ronald Coleman. Make it a point to listen each Thursday to Suspense, radio's outstanding theater of thrills. And next Thursday, same time, hear Edmund O'Brien and Anne Blythe in Muddy Track.
Autolite Suspense Show. Drive as if your life depends on it. It does. Good night. Switch to Autolite.
This is CBS, where 99 million people gather every week. The Columbia Broadcasting System. just a moment, Autolite presents Suspense with Edmund O'Brien and Anne Blank.
Say, hello.
Hello, Hap. Let me see now. Autolite electrical parts are original factory parts. When your car's electrical system needs attention, play safe. Get Autolite original factory parts, the choice of car manufacturers.
Harlow.
Gosh, I wish I could get a super simple slogan to sell all owners of Autolite-equipped cars on how important it is to replace worn parts on their generator, starting motor, or distributor, or for that matter, their complete coil and voltage regulator with Autolite original factory parts.
Mm-hmm.
You see, Hap, me hearty, here's the point. Whenever your car needs attention, whenever you need replacement parts, the smartest, safest thing you can do is drive down to your nearest Autolite service station or the dealer who sells your make of car and ask for Autolite original parts and service.
Well, naturally, Arnold. Let's hear some more about it later. Here's Suspense.
Suspense. Autolite and its 60,000 dealers and service stations bring you radio's outstanding theater of thrills. Starring tonight, Mr. Edmund O'Brien and Miss Anne Blythe in Anton Leder's production of Muddy Tracks, a tale well calculated to keep you in suspense.
They say to me, don't be bitter, Harry. Well, I'm not bitter. They say, forget it, Harry. That I can't do. I'll never be able to forget it or her. How did it happen? Well, like practically every important thing that ever happens to anybody, it just happened. I was in the bar, see?
Got a match? I said, got a match.
Who, me?
What's the matter? Girl shy or just match shy?
I thought you were talking to the bartender. Here you are.
Well, glad we got that straightened out. What are you drinking?
Coke.
At this hour?
Clear me up on something, Angel Face. Are we trying to get acquainted with each other?
You're cute.
I'm broke, flat, busted. Go pick yourself another target.
Have a drink on me.
I only take a round when I can buy one back.
I'm not trading. I'm buying.
You could have fooled me.
I repeat, you're cute. Eddie, give my friend the bourbon. What's the matter? Been playing the nag?
Oh, you read minds, too, eh?
Simple. Tracks open. That's a good suit you got on, and you've been nursing that coke for 20 minutes. Besides, your racing form showing.
Oh, that's pretty good. How's my future look?
Depends. What do you do for a living?
I'm glad you waited for me, Brandy.
Augie.
I like you to wait for me. When you don't wait, it makes me unhappy.
Now, there was a guy I wouldn't want to see unhappy. He was friendly, all right, but he was overdoing it. Everything about him was too set, too sharp. Clothes, manicure, even his eyes, like two blue marbles.
But, Augie, you said you wouldn't be here till 10.
So? Who's this guy?
The name's Clark, Harry Clark.
Brandy, go powder your nose.
I... Okay, Augie, you don't have to get in an uproar. Always getting...
What were you talking to Brandy about?
No kidding. Is that her name?
What were you talking about?
Believe it or not, a job.
Oh, so you're looking for a job. Where are you from?
Out of town.
Tell me, you particular what you do?
Why, what's the job?
Answering the phone.
That can't pay much.
5% of the take.
What take?
I'm Augie Pershing. I run the books in this town, and I've got a new setup. For you, if you want it.
Ah, a bookie, huh? It's a new one for me. Well, I don't know if... Say, why would you want to give me a job?
You want the job or don't you?
Well, since you put it that way, Pershing, we're in business.
Eddie, a couple more drinks. What are you drinking? Bourbon?
On second thought, I think I'll switch to brandy.
Not a good idea. Brandy lovers die young.
I'll take that chance.
You've got a lot of nerve, ain't you?
And that's all I've got. I'm flat broke. How do you feel about advances?
I don't mind them at all, so long as you keep them in cash.
I should have walked out then. It was too easy, but I couldn't kick too much. I had 25 of Persian's bucks in my pockets. I guaranteed he'd pick me up in the morning like he said. punctual. At 10:30 a.m. sharp, a big black sedan pulled up in front of my rooming house. Pershing was all smiles as we drove across town to a small apartment house. He took me up to the third floor to apartment 3B, opened the door, and handed me the key.
Well, this is where you work. Here's the scratch sheets, and there's the phone.
Ah, nice place. By the way, who's Eleanor Grayson?
Why?
Well, that's the name over the bell.
Oh, she lives in this apartment.
She know you're using the place?
You just answered the phone.
Yeah, but suppose she came in?
Look, you get here at 11 and pull out at 4. She'll never see you. That's the way I want it all the time, understand?
But how do
I... She thinks Brenda uses the apartment.
Does she?
You're too nosy, and you talk too much.
Is that advice?
Yeah, let's call it that. The boys have passed the word around about the new phone. You ought to be getting action pretty quick. Write up all the bets you take. I'll call you up from time to time with results. So long.
It was one of those small apartments with a pull-down bed, but it was kind of nice. The sun came in at the windows of the living room. I had it in mind to explore the kitchen for a cup of coffee, but Pershing was right. The word had got around. Hello?
This is J.K. Give me 5 win, 5 show on oatmeal and a third at Pimlico.
5 win, 5 show, oatmeal. Okay, J.K.
By the way, how's the track there?
Let's see. Pimlico? Raining, but still fast.
Okay, thanks.
I was in business. I still had the coffee on my mind, but I had something else on my mind, too. The picture of a girl smiling at me alongside the telephone. Good to have company, even if it was only a picture frame, because I was beginning to develop a queer, creepy feeling. And again, I thought, maybe I ought to get out. But they kept me too busy. It was almost 1 o'clock, and I still hadn't had that cup of coffee. The phone kept ringing, and the girl in the picture kept smiling. I felt kind of cold all of a sudden, maybe because I hadn't eaten all day. I headed for the kitchen, thinking there'd be some eggs at least, maybe some bacon. There was one of those swinging doors to the kitchen. I pushed it open. She was lying at the end of the kitchen, near the sink, all lumped up, her blonde hair matted with blood. I grabbed the stove to keep my legs from buckling. I was glad I hadn't eaten, but I turned her over just the same. It was Brandy. She was dead. So that's why Augie Pershing hired me. And I'd called him a sucker.
For suspense, Autolite is bringing you Edmund O'Brien and Anne Blythe in radio's outstanding theater of thrills, Suspense.
Is it really as important as Autolite says to replace worn-out electrical parts in my car with original factory parts?
Important? Why, by Cornelius, the Autolite people are the world's largest independent manufacturers of original factory parts for automobiles. More than 10 million cars are equipped with Autolite parts.
No.
Think of it. Generators, distributors, coils, starting motors, spark plugs, batteries, and a whole host of other automotive parts are made by Autolite. And every one of those parts is precision designed by Autolite engineers who know cars better than old Dobbin knows his oats.
Sure do.
By Cornelius, your car will take to original factory parts like ducks take to water. And listen to this, Hap. That Autolite service...
Authorized factory service, too?
Yes, authorized factory service, too, Hap. Why, those skilled Autolite servicemen are factory trained to pamper, pet, putter, and pry till they get pinpoint perfection from every electrical unit in your car. Let me tell you, that combination of Autolite original factory parts plus Autolite authorized factory service is unbeatable, unmatchable, unexcellable.
Tut-tut, Harlow, it's time to become suspensible.
And now, Autolite brings back to a Hollywood soundstage Mr. Edmund O'Brien as Harry and Miss Anne Blythe as Eleanor in Muddy Track, a tale well calculated to keep you in suspense.
A whole lot different than she had last night. Her mascara had mixed with tears, and her face was bruised. Somebody had given her the backhand treatment. It had all the earmarks of a fine Persian hand. But the thing that had put her out of circulation was a blow on the back of her head. So Augie Persian had fitted me out for a murder rap. That's why he was so anxious to hire a guy he didn't know anything about. The doorbell. Who could that be? I looked around. I was three floors up, and no fire escape, no back door. All I could do was hope they'd go away. Too late.
Oh, I didn't think anybody was here.
What do you want?
Well, this is the day I clean up and change the
room. Not now. You can let it go until tomorrow.
But I don't usually come here tomorrow.
I said let it go.
Hi, who are you?
Never mind, never mind. Here's a dollar for your trouble.
Oh, thank you, but I don't think I should take it.
Make it next week. I had to force myself to wait there till I could be sure she'd gone away to clean another apartment. Finally, I let myself out, carefully. It was good to get out on the street again. People, kids, and somewhere, somebody laughed. If I hurried, I had a fair chance of getting out of town. I could keep out of Persian's way. I walked all the way to my rooming house, and the thought hit me. Stop me cold. I'd left them all over the place. I started back on the double, ran all three flights up to the apartment, opened the door with the key Persian had given me. Fingerprints. I had to get rid of them all. I picked up the phone, wiped it clean. The kitchen. I tried to keep my eyes away from her, but I couldn't help it. She looked so pitiful there on the floor. And then I noticed something clutched in her hand. A pasteboard. I carefully forced a hand open. It was a pawn ticket. I put it in my pocket and started to get up. It was the girl in the picture. She was leaning against the kitchen door, a face white with shock.
Is she dead?
Yes.
Who are you? What are you doing here?
How did you get in this apartment?
I live here.
Oh, and you're Eleanor Grayson.
Yes, who are you?
I'll ask the questions. Come on, I'm a detective. Let's get out of here. I herded her out of the apartment. She thought I was taking her down to the station, but I steered her into a chop suey joint. I ordered some tea for her. She looked like she was going to faint. She drank it. Feel better?
Oh, yes. Yes, thank you. I'm sorry to be such a bother.
I guess it was quite a shock.
No. No, not really.
What do you mean?
Brandy was a strange girl, always getting into trouble. Always getting mixed up with the wrong sort of men.
You've known her long?
All my life. We're from the same town. Came here together. Shared the apartment for a while. She worked on the elevator next to mine in the Broadway building, but she hated it. And then one day a photographer rode in her car, and the next day she was a model. That's when she took the name of Brandy. Her real name is Evangeline. She had the face of a Madonna, but
I know. I met her. Looked like uptown, talked like downtown.
That must be...
Yeah. Now, take it easy. Take it easy. Now, tell me, what was she doing in your apartment today?
She paid half the rent. Well, she said she needed to use the phone for modeling appointments, but I never really believed that. I needed the money. I shouldn't have let her. Now I'll get into trouble. She was killed in my apartment. Now they'll blame it onto me.
Look, why don't you go away and stay with a friend? You're in no shape to go back there.
You're very understanding for a policeman.
You'd be surprised about us policemen.
You'll help me.
Well, I'll do what I can.
You promise?
Yeah, sure. Don't bank on it too much, but everything I can. It was a lousy trick to lie to her like that. Poor kid. She'd be all right. And I needed time. That siren meant that the chase had started. It was my skin I had to worry about. I put her on a streetcar, then I headed in the opposite direction on another one. I had to transfer twice to reach the spot I was bound for. The safest way to get out of town. About an hour later, in a diner on the outskirts of town, I found my boy.
Yeah, I'll give you a ride, Mac, but I ain't highballing out till midnight. And I can't pick you up here. Insurance spot is around. Know where Fremont turns into Kelso by 101?
Yeah, I'll find it.
Well, look, be there by the signal a little after 12. I'll pick you up.
I went back to my rooming house to get my stuff. My rent was paid. I wouldn't have to see anybody. I'd sure be glad to get out of this town.
You made me lose a bet, Clark.
He was a fat man. He was holding a cigar. He put the cigar in his mouth, and I was conscious of dimples. Three of them. One in his chin, one in each cheek. I had never seen him before.
Yeah, I bet you wouldn't be fool enough to come back here.
What do you want?
I'm the contented type. I hardly ever want nothing. But Augie does. Augie Persian. He wants to see you. Bad.
I didn't say anything. I didn't have any words to argue with the gun he pressed against me as we went down the stairs. There was a car about halfway down the block, a big black sedan. I knew that once I got into that car, the chances were I wouldn't climb out again. So I made a run for it. Ducked into an alley.
Don't be a sucker, Clark.
I hid behind a bulge of a chimney. As he came around, I let him have it.
Oh, right in the stomach. He went down like a paper sack filled with water.
He just sat there and grinned, holding onto his belly, sucking in air like an asthmatic. I ran to the other end of the alley and rolled my first seven when I hit a bus sign advertising beds at half a buck a throw. This would be my hideout until 11:30 when I'd catch my truck ride. I hit the pillow, shut my eyes. When I woke up, the sun was coming through the dirty windows. There were two old men talking close by.
No, sirree. You don't catch me leaving town with that dragnet the cops got spread.
Well, what time is it?
About 7 o'clock.
7 o'clock? In the morning?
Well, that ain't the moon shining out there.
I'd lost my chance to get out of town. But what was worse, dragnet, he said. I had to find out. I dashed out onto the street to buy a paper, and then I discovered it. I was cleaner. Somebody in the flophouse had rolled me. I didn't have a penny. And the newsboy hollering his head off about mysterious man sorting models killing. I couldn't afford to float around town with no dough. I couldn't afford the chance of ending up in a police lineup. And I certainly couldn't afford to let Persian get his hooks into me. There was only one other person I knew. I had to risk seeing her. I made my way to the center of town. I went through an arcade into the Broadway building and watched the elevators. She was running the second one from the right. I went up to the top floor on one of the others and got off and waited. When her car registered near the top and nobody was in the hall, I pressed the button to signal.
Down, please.
I've got to talk to you.
You're not a detective. You didn't fool me for long.
I know. I'm sorry about that, but...
Did you kill her?
Why would I want to kill her? I just met her last night in a bar.
But you were in the apartment leaning over.
I know. It looks bad, but you got to believe me.
That's the starter signal. I have to go.
Please, wait. Wait, I haven't got anybody to turn to but you.
They're looking for you.
I know.
The cleaning woman told... I wouldn't want you to think that I'll lose my job.
Please, please.
The police have been in the building all day. You'll get caught here.
You've got to believe me. I didn't kill Brandy.
I've got to go. Please, they'll catch
me. Look. I'm broke. I haven't got a nickel. You got to help me. I got to talk to you.
Well, here's a dollar. I'll try to get you more later. I get off work at 6. Meet me at the Chinese restaurant where you took me yesterday.
Okay. Thanks. The buck was crumpled in my fist till I got out of the building. Then I stuck it in my pocket and discovered a little piece of paper and got there first. It was the pawn ticket. The ticket I'd taken out of Brandy's hand when I found her in the kitchen of the apartment. It might be nothing. It might be something. I had to find out. Hey, bud.
Are you talking to me?
Yeah, can you tell me where the Acme pawn shop is?
Sure, right down the block there.
Oh, thanks.
Hey, mister, not that way, the other way.
I knew which way I was going, all right, because in front of that pawn shop, I'd seen a long black car, and sitting behind the wheel was Augie Pershing. I spent the next 2 hours in a movie, but I don't know what the picture was about. The pawn ticket kept bothering me. And Eleanor, was she really on my side? Could I depend on her? I decided to go to the Chinese restaurant, all right, but I wouldn't go in. I'd wait a few doors down the street. If she was on the level, she'd come alone. Here I am.
What? You said the restaurant.
Hi. Are you hungry?
No.
Let's walk.
It won't be safe to walk. They're looking for you.
Oh, come on. We can't stand here.
Well, there's the park across the street. It'll be dark soon.
All right.
You look tired.
I am. I'm dead.
Here's a bench. Why don't we sit down?
Okay. No, maybe it isn't such a good idea.
Why not?
Well, parks are full of cops snooping around. Maybe we'd better go, huh?
No, let's stay. Here, sit down. Oh, it's nice here.
Yeah.
Quiet. No elevators, no noise, no people.
Poor kid. I forgot. Isn't easy for you either, is it?
I'm worried about you. What are you going to do?
I don't know. I don't know if I only had something to go on. Wait a minute. There is something. I almost forgot it.
What?
The pawn ticket.
Pawn ticket?
Yeah, I found it in Brandy's hand.
Let me see it.
I got it right here.
Kiss me.
Huh?
There's a policeman. He's coming this way. Hurry up and kiss me.
I held her in a clinch until the cop's footsteps disappeared past us. Every nerve tight as a stretched tendon. And then, suddenly, the tightness was gone. And there was something else in its place. It had started out as just a prop kiss, just a guy and a gal on a park bench. But that wasn't what it turned into. Eleanor.
Well, Harry.
I didn't notice it before. You're beautiful. All day I've been running and running. Just now, 30 seconds ago, I started to slow up.
I know. There isn't much time, Harry. Please let me see the pawn ticket.
Sure, honey. Got it right here.
What's the matter?
That car down there.
Where?
Big black sedan. Look, see? Just stopped without lights. Persian's car.
Persian?
Yeah, but how did he know where I was?
Harry, give me the pawn ticket.
We've got to get away from here, Eleanor. Come on.
No, wait.
Come on, don't be silly. Come on, hurry.
Stop.
What are you doing with that gun?
Never mind. Just hand over the pawn ticket.
Why are you so anxious to have it? What's this all about?
Don't ask questions. Just give me the ticket.
All right, Eleanor. Put down the gun. Go ahead. I'll give it to you.
No tricks now.
Oh, of course not. No tricks.
Oh,
Don't move, Clark. This is the gun I got through. See if she's dead, Dimples.
Okay, Augie.
We were fighting for the gun. It went off. I don't understand why
she... Don't ever trust a dame, Clark. Any dame. Eleanor told us you'd be here. In the Chinese restaurant or the park. She called me.
What? She called you?
She ain't dead, Augie. But she ain't gonna live very long.
Looks like crime doesn't pay, Eleanor, huh?
Don't kill him, Persian.
Me kill Harry? Oh, no, Eleanor. You were the target for tonight.
Me?
Yes. But you saved me the trouble.
Persian, you're crazy. You're crazy.
Nah, you are, Clark, for trusting her. Why don't you tell him, Eleanor? Tell him why you killed Brandy. How you'd been hacking her clothes, her jewelry. How she finally caught up with you.
I didn't mean to kill her. She found a pawn ticket. Threatened to have me arrested. She slapped me and we had a fight. She fell and hit her head on the sink. I didn't know what to do. Ran away.
And just then a perfect fall guy turned up. Friend Harry here.
That's why she needed this pawn ticket.
What pawn ticket?
This one.
Huh? Well, this ties it all up. She had to have this. Even if I had fallen for a double cross and rubbed you out, this ticket would still point to her.
Harry.
What, Eleanor? Tell me.
I didn't want to. If only we'd met before,
Well, that apartment is now available for new tenants.
We better beat it, Augie.
Yeah. Come on, Harry. You know, I tried to catch up to you all day to give you protection.
Oh, shut up.
Yeah, I know, kid. I know. I had a girl, too.
Leave me alone.
Now, look, kid.
Leave me alone. I said, shut up. Shut up.
Thank you, Edmund O'Brien and Anne Blythe, for a splendid performance. Mr. O'Brien and Miss Blythe will be back in just a moment.
Hello. Where in the world do you get all those Autolite adjectives you throw around?
Ah, those aren't adjectives. Those are facts. And the fact is, I, old Harlow A. for Autolite Wilcox, would give a mountain of money for a meaty, memorable motto to remind America's millions of owners of Autolite-equipped cars to accept no substitute for Autolite parts. For there is no substitute for Autolite parts. So, friends, if you want really reliable electrical parts and service, drive down to your nearest Autolite service station or the dealer who sells your make of car and ask for Autolite original factory parts and service. Tell him I sent you and you'll be taken care of extra pronto.
Pronto? Listen.
Autolite? You will find Autolite service stations listed in your classified telephone directory under Automotive Electrical Equipment. And remember, your Autolite electrical system is the lifeline of your car.
Right, friends. And here's something else to remember. Autolite means spark plugs.
Ignition-engineered spark plugs.
Autolite means batteries.
Stay full batteries.
Autolite means ignition systems.
The lifeline of your car.
And now here again is Mr. Edmund O'Brien.
I'd like to say for Anne Blythe and myself that it's been a pleasure to appear on Suspense tonight.
That's right, Eddie. And next week we'll be listening to one of the most famous of all suspense shows, Agnes Moorehead in Sorry, Wrong Number. And that is really tops in.
Suspense.
Anne Blythe appeared through the courtesy of Universal International and can now be seen in Mr. Peabody and the Mermaid, released by Universal International. Edmund O'Brien may soon be seen in Warner Brothers' Technicolor production, Fighter Squadron. Tonight's suspense play was written by Bob Shelley and Buckley Angel, with music composed by Lucian Morawek and conducted by Lud Bluskin. The entire production was under the direction of Anton M. Leader. In the coming weeks, Suspense will present such stars as Ronald Coleman, Rosalind Russell, James Cagney, Margaret O'Brien, Claude Rains, and Peter Lorre. Make it a point to listen each Thursday to Suspense, radio's outstanding theater of thrills. And next Thursday, same time, hear Agnes Moorehead in Sorry, Wrong Number.
This is the Autolite Suspense Show. On this Armistice Day, Autolite is proud to join all America in a salute to the United States Marine Corps on its 173rd anniversary. Good night. Switch to Autolite.
This is CBS, the Columbia Broadcasting System. In just a moment, Autolite presents Suspense, starring Miss Agnes Moorhead in radio's most famous play, Sorry, Wrong Number.
Say, Harlow, have you seen State's football team? They're terrific.
Speaking of terrific teams, Hap, my friend, the one that ignition engineered those Autolite resistor spark plugs is Tops. You know, the Autolite people got together with many of the nation's leading car and truck manufacturers, and they ignition engineered a 10,000-ohm resistor right into the Autolite spark plug that permits a wider spark gap setting and maintains it far longer than was ever possible before. You know what that means to your car?
Smooth. That's the word for State's football team. Smooth.
Right you are. Smooth. Thanks to the wide gap, Autolite resistor spark plugs help your engine idle smooth as silk. And that's only one of the simple, sound, solid, splendid advantages of those sensational Autolite resistor spark plugs.
Got it all off your chest, Arno?
Sure have, Hap. You're not going to hear one more word out of me till we've heard the whole suspense show.
No?
No middle commercial tonight, Hap. Autolite doesn't want us to interrupt Agnes Moorhead's performance in that famous drama, Sorry, Wrong Number.
Okay, Harlow. Let's hear suspense.
Suspense. Autolite and its 60,000 dealers and service stations bring you radio's outstanding theater of thrills. Starring tonight, Miss Agnes Moorhead in Anton Leder's production of Lucille Fletcher's famous suspense play, Sorry, Wrong Number. A tale well calculated to keep you in suspense.
Operator, I've been dialing Murray Hill 40098 now for the last three quarters of an hour, and the line is always busy. I don't see how it could be busy that long. Will you try it for me, please?
I will be glad to try that number for you. One moment, please.
I don't see how it could be busy all this time. It's my husband's office. He's working late tonight, and I'm here all alone in the house. My health is very poor, and I've been feeling so nervous all day.
Ringing. Murray Hill 40098.
Hello?
Hello? Hello, is Mr. Stevenson there?
Hello, hello.
Hello?
Hello, George?
Yes, sir. This is George speaking.
Hello, who's this? What number am I calling, please?
I'm here with our client, George.
Oh, good. Everything okay? Is the coast clear for tonight?
Yes, George. He says the coast is clear for tonight.
Okay. Okay.
Where are you now?
In a phone booth.
What
Don't
number?
Worry. Everything's okay.
Very well. You know the address.
I know. I know. At 11 o'clock, the private patrolman goes around to the bar on 2nd Avenue for a beer.
That's right. 11 o'clock.
Okay.
Now, be sure that all the lights downstairs are out. There should be only one light visible from the street.
Okay, okay.
Just a minute, George. Oh, our client tells me that at 11:15 a train crosses the bridge. It makes a noise in case her window's open and she should scream.
Oh, hello, what number is this, please?
Okay, I understand. That's 11:15, the train.
Yeah, you remember everything else, George?
Yes, I'll make it quick. As little blood as possible, because our client does not wish to make her suffer long.
That's right. You'll use a knife?
Yes, the knife will be okay. Then afterwards, I remove the rings and bracelets and the jewelry in the bureau drawer, because our client wishes it to look like simple robbery. Don't worry. Everything's okay. I never...
Oh. Oh, how awful. How unspeakably awful.
Your call.
Operator,
please.
I've just been cut off.
I'm sorry. What number were you calling?
Why, it was supposed to be Murray Hill 40098, but it wasn't. Some wires must have got crossed. I was cut into a wrong number, and I've just heard the most dreadful thing, something about a murder. And, operator, you simply got to retrace that call at once.
I beg your pardon. May I help you?
Oh, I know it was a wrong number, and I had no business listening, but these two men, they were cold-blooded fiends, and they were going to murder somebody, some poor innocent woman who was all alone in a house near a bridge. And we've got to stop them. We've just got to.
What number are you calling, please?
Well, that doesn't matter. This was a wrong number, and you dialed it for me, and we've got to find out who what was immediately.
What number did you call?
Oh, why are you so stupid? What time is it? Do you mean to tell me you can't find out what that number was just now?
I'll connect you with the chief operator.
Oh, I think it's perfectly shameful. Now, look, it was obviously a case of some little slip of the finger. I told you to try Murray Hill 40098 for me, and you dialed it, but your finger must have slipped, and I was connected with some other number. And I could hear them, but they couldn't hear me. Now, I simply fail to see why you couldn't make that same mistake again, on purpose. Why, you couldn't try to dial Murray Hill 40098 in the same sort of careless way.
Murray Hill 40098. I will try to get it for you.
Well, thank you.
I am sorry. Murray Hill 40098 is busy. I will call you in 20
minutes. Operator! Operator!
Your call, please.
You didn't try to get that wrong number at all. I asked you explicitly, and all you did was dial correctly.
I am sorry. What number are you calling?
Well, can't you for once forget what number I'm calling and do something for me? Now, I want to trace that call. It's my civic duty, and it's your civic duty to trace that call and apprehend those dangerous killers. And if you don't...
I will connect you with the chief operator.
Well, please. All this talk can't make anyone understand me.
This is the chief operator.
Chief operator, I want you to trace a call, a telephone call, immediately. I don't know where it came from or who was making it, but it's absolutely necessary that it be tracked down because it was about a murder that someone's planning. A terrible, cold-blooded murder of a poor, innocent woman tonight at 11:15.
I see.
Well, can you trace it for me? Can you track down those men?
I am not certain. It depends.
Depends on what?
It depends on whether the call is still going on.
Well,
if it's a live call, we can trace it on the equipment.
Well,
if it has been disconnected, we cannot.
Disconnected?
If the parties have stopped talking to each other.
Oh, but of course they must have stopped talking to each other by now. That was at least 5 minutes ago, and they didn't sound like the type who would make a long call.
Well, I can try tracing it. May I have your name, please?
Mrs. Stevenson. Mrs. Albert Stevenson. But listen...
And your telephone number, please?
Plaza 32099. But if you go on wasting all this time...
Why do you want this call traced, please?
Why? Oh... Well, no reason. I merely felt very strongly that something ought to be done about it. These men sounded like killers. They're dangerous. They're going to murder this woman at 11:15 tonight, and I thought the police ought to know.
Have you reported this to the police?
Well, no, not yet.
You want this call checked purely as a private individual?
Yes, yes, but meanwhile...
I am sorry, Mrs. Stevenson, but I am afraid we couldn't make this check for you and trace the call just on your say-so as a private individual.
But
we will have to have something more official.
Oh, for heaven's sake, you mean to tell me I can't report that there's going to be a murder without getting tied up in all this red tape? Why, it's perfectly idiotic. Well, all right, I'll call the police.
Thank you. I am sure that would be the best way.
Ridiculous. I never heard of such nonsense. Police department. I can't see why you have to go through all this business.
Your call, please.
The police department. Get me the police department, please.
Thank you. Ringing the police department.
Oh, dear, do you have to dial? Can't you ring them direct? All this time waste.
Police Department, Precinct 43. Sergeant Martin speaking.
Police Department, this is Mrs. Stevenson. Mrs. Albert Smythe Stevenson of 53 North Sutton Place. I'm calling up to report a murder.
Huh?
I mean, the murder hasn't been committed yet, but I just overheard plans for it over the telephone. Over a wrong number that the operator gave me. I've been trying to trace down the call myself, but everybody is so stupid. And I guess in the end, you're the only people who could do anything.
Yes, ma'am.
It was a perfectly definite murder. I heard their plans distinctly. Two men were talking, and they were going to murder some woman at 11:15 tonight. And she lived in a house near a bridge. Are you listening to me?
Yes, ma'am.
And there was a private patrolman on the street. He was going to go around for a beer on 2nd Avenue. And there was some third man, a client, who was paying to have this poor woman murdered. They were going to take her rings and bracelets and use a knife. Well, it's unnerved me dreadfully, and I'm not well.
When was all this, ma'am?
About 8 minutes ago. Oh, then you can do something. You do understand.
What is your name, ma'am?
Mrs. Stevenson. Mrs. Albert Stevenson.
And your address?
53 North Sutton Place. That's near a bridge. The Queensborough Bridge, you know. And we have a private patrol on our street. And 2nd Avenue is the next street.
What was that number you were calling?
Murray Hill 40098. But that wasn't the number I overheard. I mean, Murray Hill 40098 is my husband's office. He's working late tonight, and I was trying to reach him to ask him to come home. I'm an invalid, you know, and it's the maid's night off, and I hate to be alone, even though he says I'm perfectly safe as long as I have the telephone right beside my bed.
Well, we'll look into it, Mrs. Stevenson, and see if we can check it with the telephone company.
But the telephone company said they couldn't check the call if the parties had stopped talking. I've already taken care of that.
Oh, you have?
Yes, and personally, I feel you ought to do something far more immediate and drastic than just check the call.
Well, now,
what good
you
is
see,
checking the call do if they stop talking? By the time you tracked it down, they've already committed the murder.
Well, we'll take care of it, don't you worry.
I'd say the whole thing calls for a search, a complete and thorough search of the whole city. Why, I'm very near the bridge, and I'm not far from 2nd Avenue, and I know I'd feel a whole lot better if you sent around a radio car to this neighborhood at once.
And what makes you think the murder's going to be committed in your neighborhood, ma'am?
Well, I don't know. Only the coincidence is so horrible. 2nd Avenue and the patrolman and the bridge.
Well, 2nd Avenue's a very long street, ma'am, and well, you know how many bridges there are in the city of New York, to mention Brooklyn, Staten Island, Queens, and the Bronx. Now, how do you know there isn't some little house on Staten Island, on some little 2nd Avenue you've never heard about? Well, how do you know they were even talking about New York at all?
But I heard the call on the New York dialing system.
Well, maybe it was a long-distance call you overheard.
Oh, I...
Telephones are funny things now. Look, lady, why don't you look at it this way? Supposing you hadn't broken in on that telephone call. Supposing you'd got your husband the way you always do. You wouldn't be so upset, would you?
Well, I know. I suppose not. Only it sounded so inhuman, so cold-blooded.
A lot of murders are plotted in this city every day, ma'am. We manage to prevent almost all of them. The clue of this kind is so vague, it isn't much more use to us than no clue at all.
But surely you...
Unless, of course, you have some reason for thinking this call was phony or that someone may be planning to murder you.
Me? Oh, it... Well, no, I hardly think so. I mean, why should anybody? I'm alone all day and night. I see nobody except my maid, Eloise, and she's a big girl. She weighs 200 pounds. She's too lazy to bring up my breakfast tray, and the only other person is my husband, Albert. He's crazy about me. He just adores me. He waits on me hand and foot. He has scarcely left my side since I took sick 12 years ago.
Well, then, there's nothing for you to worry about. Now, if you'll just leave the rest of this to us, we'll take care of it.
But what will you do? It's so late. It's nearly 11 now.
We'll take care of it, lady.
Well, will you broadcast it all over the city and send out squads and warn your radio cars to watch out, especially in suspicious neighborhoods like mine?
Lady, I said we'd take care of it. Just now, I've got a couple of other matters here on my desk that require immediate attention. Good night, ma'am, and thank you.
Oh, you idiot! Oh, no. Why did I hang up the phone like that? Now he'll think I am a fool. Oh, why doesn't Albert come home? Why doesn't he? I'm the operator again.
Your call, please.
Operator, for heaven's sake, will you ring that Murray Hill 40098 number again? I can't think what's keeping him so long.
I will try to get it for you.
Well, try.
I don't see why he doesn't answer. I'm so...
I am sorry. Murray Hill 40098 is busy. I will call you.
I can hear it. You don't have to tell me. I know it's busy.
Oh, if I could only get out of this bed for a little while. If I could get a breath of fresh air and just lean out of the window and see the street.
Hello, Albert? Hello? 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 Oh, what's the matter with this phone? Hello? 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 Oh, for heaven's sake, who is this? Hello? 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 He's trying to call me. What are they trying to do?
Your call, please.
Hello, operator. I don't know what's the matter with this phone tonight, but it's positively driving me crazy. I've never seen such inefficient, miserable service. Now, look, I'm an invalid, and I'm very nervous, and I'm not supposed to be annoyed. But if this keeps on much longer...
What seems to be the trouble?
Please. Well, everything's wrong. I haven't had one bit of satisfaction out of one call I've made this evening. The whole world could be murdered for all you people care, and now my phone keeps ringing and ringing and ringing and ringing every 5 seconds, and when I pick it up, there's no one there.
I am sorry. If you will hang up, I will test it for
you. I don't want you to test it for me. I want you to put that call through, whatever it is, at once.
I'm afraid I cannot do that.
You cannot? Well, why? Why, may I ask?
The dial system is automatic.
Oh, I...
If someone is trying to dial your number, there is no way to check whether the call is coming through the system or not.
Oh,
unless the person is trying to reach you, complains to his particular operator.
Oh, of all the stupid... And meanwhile, I've got to sit here in my bed suffering every time that phone rings, imagining everything.
I will try to check the trouble
for
you.
Check it. That's all anybody can do. Oh, what's the use of talking to you? You're so stupid. Oh, I'll fix her. Of all the impudent... How dare she speak to me like that? How dare she speak to me like that? It takes so long to answer.
Your call, please.
Young woman, I don't know your name, but there are ways of finding you out. And I'm going to report you to your superiors for the most unpardonable rudeness and insolence it has ever been my privilege. Give me the business office at once.
You may dial that number direct.
Dial it direct? I'll do no such thing. I don't even know the number.
The number is in the directory, or you may secure it by dialing information.
Listen here, you... Oh, what's the use? Oh, dear. Oh, for heaven's sake, I'm going out of my mind. I'm going out of my mind. Hello? Hello, stop ringing me. Do you hear? Answer me. Who is this? Do you realize you're driving me crazy? Who's calling me? What are you doing it for? Now, stop it. Stop it. Stop it, I say. Hello? If you don't stop ringing me, I'm going to call the police. You hear? The police. If Albert would only come home. Oh, let it ring. Let it go on ringing. It's a trick of some kind. I won't answer it. I won't, even if it goes on ringing all night. Just ring all night. I don't... What's the matter? Why did they stop ringing all of a sudden? Oh, what time is it? Where's my clock? Where is it? Where did I put it? 5 to 11. Oh, they've decided something. They're sure I'm home. They heard my voice answer them just now. That's why they've been ringing me. Why, no one has answered me. Call the operator again. Where is she? Why doesn't she answer?
Your call, please.
Where were you just now? Why didn't you answer at once? Give me the police department.
I am sorry. The line is busy. I will call you.
Busy? But that's impossible. The police department can't be busy. There must be other lines available.
The line is busy. I will try to get them later.
No. I've got to speak to them now, or it may be too late. I've got to get to someone.
What number do you wish to speak to?
Well, I don't know, but there must be someone to protect people beside the police department. A detective agency.
You will find detective agencies listed in the classified directory.
But I don't have a classified. I mean, I'm too nervous to look it up, and I don't know how to use it.
I will connect you with information. Perhaps they will be able to help you.
Oh, no.
Oh, you're being spiteful, aren't you? You don't care, do you, what happens to me? I could die and you wouldn't care. Oh, stop it! Stop it, I can't stand anymore. Hello, what do you want? Stop ringing, will you? Stop it!
Hello, is this Plaza 32099?
Oh, yes. Yes, I'm sorry. This is Plaza 32099.
This is Western Union. I have a telegram here for Mrs. Elbert Stevenson. Is there anyone there to receive the message?
I am Mrs. Stevenson.
The telegram is as follows. Mrs. Elbert Stevenson, 53 North Sutton Place, New York, New York, darling. Terribly sorry. Try to get you for last hour, but line busy. Leaving for Boston 11 p.m. tonight on urgent business.
Oh.
Back tomorrow afternoon. Keep happy. Love, signed Elbert.
Oh, no.
You wish us to deliver a copy of the message?
No. No, thank you.
Thank you, madam. Good night.
Good night. No. No, I don't believe it. He couldn't do it. He couldn't do it, not when he knows I'll be all alone in some trick, some fiendish trick. In some...
Your call, please.
Operator, try that Murray Hill 40098 number for me just once more, please.
You may dial that number direct.
Oh. M. U. Tonight. I just can't. If I'm alone one more second, I'll go mad. I don't care what he says or what the expense is. I'm a sick woman. I'm entitled to some consideration.
This is information. May I help you?
I want the telephone number of Henchley Hospital.
Henchley Hospital? Do you have the street address?
No, it's somewhere in the 70s. It's a very small, private, and exclusive hospital where I had my appendix out 2 years ago. Henchley, H-E-N-C-H.
One moment, please.
Please hurry. And please, what is the time?
You may find out the time by dialing Meridian 71212.
For heaven's sake, I've no time to be dialing.
The number of Henchley Hospital is Butterfield 89970.
You. 8 9 9 7 0.
Henchley Hospital, good evening.
Give me the nurse's registry.
Who was it you wish to speak to, please?
I want the nurse's registry at once. I want a trained nurse. I want to hire immediately for the night.
I see. And what is the nature of the case, madam?
Nerves. I'm very nervous. I need soothing and companionship. You see, my husband is away, and I'm all...
Have you been recommended to us by any doctor in particular, madam?
No, but I really don't see why all this catechizing is necessary. I want a trained nurse. I was a patient in your hospital 2 years ago, and after all, I do expect to pay this person for attending me.
We quite understand that, madam. But registered nurses are very scarce just now. Our superintendent has asked us to send people out only on cases where the physician in charge feels it is absolutely necessary.
Well, it is absolutely necessary. I'm a sick woman. I'm very upset. Very. I'm alone in this house, and I'm an invalid, and tonight I overheard a telephone conversation that upset me dreadfully. A woman's going to be killed when a train comes. In fact, if someone doesn't come at once, I'm afraid I'll go out of my mind.
I see. Well, I will speak to Miss Phillips as soon as she comes in.
Miss Phillips?
And what is your name, madam?
When do you expect her in?
I really couldn't say. She went out to supper at 11 o'clock.
11 o'clock? Oh, but it's not 11 yet. Oh, my clock has stopped. I thought it was running down. What time is it?
Just 15 minutes past 11.
What was that?
What was what, madam?
That click just now in my own telephone, as though someone had lifted the receiver off the hook, off the extension telephone downstairs.
I didn't hear it, madam. Now about
this nurse.
I did. There's someone in this house, someone downstairs in the kitchen, and they're listening to me now. That is... Oh, I won't pick it up again. I won't let them hear me. I'll be quiet, and then they'll think... Oh, but if I don't call someone now while they're still down there, there'll be no time. I've got to get to that operator.
Your call, please.
Operator, I'm in desperate trouble. I
am sorry, I cannot hear you. Please speak louder.
I don't dare. There's someone listening. Can you hear me now?
I am sorry.
Oh, but you've got to hear me. Oh, please, you've got to help me. There's someone in this house. Someone who's going to murder me. And you've got to get in touch with the police. Oh, there it is. Did you hear it? He's put it down. He's put down the extension phone. He's coming up the stairs. Oh, give me the police department. Give me the police department.
One moment, police please. I will connect you.
Oh, hurry. Oh, hurry, I can hear him. He's coming here. Oh, no. Oh, what are you going to do to me? Oh, no. Oh, no, don't come near me. I haven't done anything, please. Oh, don't hurt me. No.
Sergeant Martin speaking. Hello, Police Department, Precinct 43. Sergeant Martin speaking.
Police Department?
Yes.
Oh, I'm sorry. Must have got the wrong number. Don't worry. Everything's okay.
Thank you, Miss Agnes Moorhead, for another memorable performance. Miss Moorhead will return in just a moment.
Say, Harlow, you got so wound up on Autolite resistor spark plugs a while back, you never told me whether you saw the state football game last week.
You bet I saw it. And say, did you notice the big gaps that state knocked in that enemy line?
Yes.
Reminded me of that wide gap in Autolite resistor spark plugs.
Now, Harlow.
You know, when you replace your old narrow gap spark plugs with wide gap Autolite resistor spark plugs, by Cornelius, your engine idles smoother. You have better luck with lean gas mixtures. Actually save gas.
Harlow, I'm talking about football. Oh, by the way, how'd you like the way State's line cut down enemy interference?
Great. Almost as good as the way Autolite resistor spark plugs cut down spark plug interference with radio and television reception.
What a team.
Yes, friends, when it comes to team play, you really get it with those sensational new Autolite resistor spark plugs. Another Autolite engineering first. And no wonder, for Autolite resistor spark plugs are one of over 400 automotive, aviation, and marine parts made by the 26 nationwide Autolite plants, all famous for Autolite engineered dependability. So, friends, don't dilly-dally, dawdle, or delay, but hop down tomorrow to your friendly Autolite dealer and get a set of wonderful new wide-gap Autolite resistor spark plugs. He's got just the type and size to fit your car. And, friends, remember, too... Autolite means spark plug.
Ignition engineered resistor spark plug.
Autolite means batteries.
Stay full batteries.
Autolite means ignition system.
The lifeline of your car.
And now here again is Miss Agnes Moorhead.
My thanks to producer Tony Leader for affording me this opportunity to play Lucille Fletcher's wonderful story once again. And my thanks to the cast and the musicians and sound men who helped make it successful. The suspense program will always hold a special place in my affections, and I'll be listening with great interest next Thursday when radio's outstanding theater of thrills brings us little Margaret O'Brien starring in Ray Bradbury's story, The Screaming Woman. Another gripping study in...
Suspense.
Agnes Moorhead has recorded Sorry Wrong Number in album form. Miss Moorhead may currently be seen in the Warner Brothers picture Johnny Belinda. Music on tonight's suspense play was composed by Lucian Morawek and conducted by Lud Bluskin. The entire production was under the direction of Anton M. Leader. In the coming weeks, Suspense will present such stars as Ronald Coleman, Rosalind Russell, Claude Rains, and William Bendix. Make it a point to listen each Thursday to Suspense, radio's outstanding theater of thrills. And next Thursday, same time, hear Margaret O'Brien in The Screaming Woman.
This is the Autolite Suspense Show. Volunteers are needed for the armed forces of the United States. Your nearest recruiting station will have complete information. Good night. Switch to Autolite.
This is CBS, the Columbia Broadcasting System.
When I got here, she wanted a couple of more days, and I gave it to her. But today, she double-crossed me and married you. Two double-crosses. You can see the position that put me in, Tommy. It's bad for business.
Tell me, Lou, did she know about me? You know what I mean?
Yeah, she knew. I guess she thought the two of you could break the bank.
Sure, Lou, you had to do it. But you made some mistakes. You made one... Well, what's the gun for?
Oh, I just feel more comfortable holding it this way, Tommy. Don't let it bother you, though. Go on. What were my mistakes?
One of them was not thinking I'd come here to your room and find you alone. But the big one was when you killed Helen. You shouldn't have done that.
Well, now, Tommy, don't let it get you down. Maybe I can fix it.
It's too late now. We've all had our last chance. The way you'd put it, the bets are all down. And the wheel's starting to slow up.
Well. Maybe you can tell me what number it's stopping on, Tommy.
Sure, Lou. The house takes everything.
What?
It's already stopped on 00.
Eaten, but I turned her over just the same. It was Brandy. She was dead. So that's why Augie Pershing hired me. And I'd called him a sucker.
For Suspense, Autolite is bringing you Edmund O'Brien and Anne Blythe in radio's outstanding theater of thrills, Suspense.
Say, Harlow, is it really as important as Autolite says to replace worn-out electrical parts in my car with original factory parts?
Important? Why, by Cornelius, the Autolite people are the world's largest independent manufacturers of original factory parts for automobiles. More than 10 million cars are equipped with Autolite parts.
No.
Think of it. Generators, distributors, coils, starting motors, spark plugs, batteries, and a whole host of other automotive parts are made by Autolite. And every one of those parts is precision designed by Autolite engineers who know cars better than old Dobbin knows his oats.
Sure do.
By Cornelius, your car will take to original factory parts like ducks take to water. And listen to this, Hap. That Autolite service...
Authorized factory service, too?
Yes, authorized factory service, too, Hap. By those skilled Autolite servicemen...
Party in the hotel. Come along.
Who's party?
Lou Cromwell's.
Say, he'll be surprised to see me.
Oh, you'll love it, Tommy. Come on.
Okay, let's go to your party.
Hiya, Tommy Johnson. Hiya, Tommy.
Hiya, Tommy.
What do you say, fella? What do you know?
Well, it doesn't look like Lou's shown up yet.
Well, what's he celebrating?
Well, he hasn't said yet. Say, why'd you come back, Tommy?
Why shouldn't I? It's a nice town.
Sure, except when Lou Cromwell doesn't want it to be.
Meaning?
Oh, nothing much. I'm only a columnist, Tommy. And like I said, I'm using last year's news, so I'm still interested in Maxie Dunn.
Oh, it's a dull story, Brad. The cops couldn't find Maxie, so the widow of the guy he killed hired me. I dug up a tip on Maxie's hideout and brought him in. There happened to be a 15 grand reward, so I had myself a custom-built vacation. I guess I was just born lucky.
Lou may think you ought to die the same way.
Well, I can take care of myself. Besides, why should Lou worry about it one way or the other?
Well, you have done some work for him.
Well, sure. I'm a private investigator. I work for anybody who'll pay me as long as the job's on the level. And those I did for Lou were, too.
You don't have to argue with me, Tommy. But I told you a year ago not to get mixed up with Lou. A man has to pick one side of the fence and stay there. He can't play on both sides.
I don't know, Brad. I've done pretty well at it.
Until now. But Maxie was Lou's right hand, so I don't think he liked it.
So he didn't like it. In the meantime, I'll...
Tommy!
Yeah. Oh, hello there, Muggsy.
Your call, please.
Operator, for heaven's sake, will you ring that Murray Hill 40098 number again? I can't think what's keeping him so long.
I will try to get it for
you.
Well,
try. I don't see why he doesn't answer. I'm so...
I am sorry, Murray Hill 40098 is busy. I will call you.
I can hear it. You don't have to tell me. I know it's busy.
Oh, if I could only get out of this bed for a little while. If I could get a breath of fresh air and just lean out of the window and see the street.
Hello, Albert. Hello. Oh, what's the matter with this phone? Hello. Hello? Oh, for heaven's sake, who is this? Hello? He's trying to call me. What are they trying to do to me?
Oh. Your call, please.
Hello, operator. I don't know what's the matter with this phone tonight, but it's positively driving me crazy. I've never seen such inefficient, miserable service. Now, look, I'm an invalid. And I'm very nervous, and I'm not supposed to be annoyed. But if this keeps on much longer...
What seems to be the trouble?
Well, everything's rough.
What?
A pawn ticket.
Pawn ticket?
Yeah, I found it in Brandy's hand.
Let me see it.
I got it right here.
Kiss me.
Huh?
There's a policeman. He's coming this way. Hurry up and kiss me.
I held her in a clinch until the cop's footsteps disappeared past us. Every nerve tight as a stretched tendon. And then, suddenly... The tightness was gone, and there was something else in its place. It had started out as just a prop kiss, just a guy and a gal on a park bench. But that wasn't what it turned into. Eleanor.
Oh, Harry.
I didn't notice it before. You're beautiful.
Oh, Harry.
All day I've been running and running. Just now, 30 seconds ago, I started to slow up.
I know. There isn't much time, Harry. Please let me see the pawn ticket.
Sure, honey. Got it right here.
What's the matter?
That car down there.
Where?
Big black sedan. Look, see? Just stopped without lights. Persian's car.
Persian?
Yeah, but how did he know where I was?
Harry, give me the pawn ticket.
We've got to get away from here, Eleanor. Come on.
No, wait.
Come on, don't be silly. Come on, hurry.
Stop!
What are you doing with that gun?
Never mind. Just hand over the pawn ticket.
Tommy, did you really?
Yeah, no, I'm kidding, Helen. I've been a lot of things, though.
Yes.
So have I.
Anything besides wonderful?
Everything but that. Things have been rough sometimes.
It's that kind of a world. It may not look it in a place like this. Soft lights and white tablecloths. Nice, clean people eating nice, clean food. But down underneath, it's still rough.
You can forget it, though, while the music keeps on playing.
Yeah. How long are you planning to stay in Santa Barbara, Helen?
About a week. You?
A week? Why'd you come?
I can't tell you. And please don't ask me any questions, remember? Let's enjoy it while we can.
Yeah. Well, let's eat.
Oh, I wish it would last forever. I mean, this week.
Maybe this is forever, honey. Here we are.
Oh, thanks, Tommy. What's this? You didn't order champagne, did you?
No, they must have made it. Oh.
I sent it over, Tommy. I thought you might like it.
Nice of you, Lou. Thanks.
Well, do I get to meet the lady, or are you starting to hold out on your old friends?
Helen, this is Lou Cromwell, Miss Ludlow.
How do you do?
You two make a lovely couple. You both seem to be having a lot of fun out there on the dance floor.
That's right, we were.
I'm glad to hear it. Have all the fun you can while you're here. Life's too short to waste any of it.
When I woke up, the sun was coming through the dirty windows. There were two old men talking close by.
No, sirree. You don't catch me leaving town with that dragnet the cops got spread.
Well, what time is it?
Huh? About 7 o'clock.
7 o'clock? In the morning?
Well, that ain't the moon shining out there.
I'd lost my chance to get out of town. But what was worse, dragnet, he said. I had to find out. I dashed out onto the street to buy a paper, and then I discovered it. I was clean. Somebody in the flophouse had rolled me. I didn't have a penny. And the newsboy hollering his head off about mysterious man sought in model's killing. I couldn't afford to float around town with no dough. I couldn't afford the chance of ending up in a police lineup. And I certainly couldn't afford to let Persian get his hooks into me. There was only one other person I knew. I had to risk seeing her. I made my way to the center of town. I went through an arcade into the Broadway building and watched the elevators. She was running the second one from the right. I went up to the top floor on one of the others and got off and waited. When her car registered near the top and nobody was in the hall, I pressed the button to signal.
I didn't mean to kill her. She found a pawn ticket. Threatened to have me arrested. She slapped me and we had a fight. She fell and hit her head on the sink. I didn't know what to do. Ran away.
And just then a perfect fall guy turned up. Friend Harry here.
That's why she needed this pawn ticket.
What pawn ticket?
This one.
Huh? Well, this ties it all up. She had to have this. Even if I had fallen for a double cross and rubbed you out, this ticket would still point to her.
Harry.
What, Eleanor? Tell me.
I didn't want to. If only we'd met before,
Well, that apartment is now available for new tenants.
We better beat it, Augie.
Hey, yeah. Come on, Harry. You know, I tried to catch up to you all day to give you protection.
Oh, shut up.
Yeah, I know, kid. I know. I had a girl, too.
Well, leave me alone.
Now, look, kid. Here.
Well, leave me alone. I said shut up. Shut up.
She didn't answer, so I tried again. The door was unlocked. Helen? It's Tommy, Helen. She wasn't in the sitting room or the bedroom, so I finally opened the door to the bath. I looked around, but she wasn't in sight. Then just as I started to leave, she fell. She'd been propped up in the tub behind the shower curtain. But she fell out, hitting with a horrible limp sound. She was dead. Strangled. I stepped out and pulled the bathroom door shut, using my handkerchief to wipe off the knob without even thinking. I didn't feel anything. Except maybe a numbness that still hurt. Lou had seen how I felt about her, so he'd done this, or had it done. I tried to brush the fog out of my eyes and think, but not about her lying in there, or what might have been. No, I wasn't even thinking about my 7 days. I had something else on my mind. Finally, I stepped out into the hall and started for Lou Cromwell's room. But I...
Did you hear it? He's put it down. He's put down the extension phone. He's coming up the stairs. Oh, give me the police department. Give me the police department.
One moment, please. I will connect you.
Oh, hurry. Hurry. Oh, hurry, I can hear him. He's coming. He's coming here. Oh! Oh, no! Oh, what are you going to do to me? Oh, don't! Oh, don't come near me! I haven't done anything, please! Oh, don't hurt me! Don't!
Sergeant Martin speaking. Hello, Police Department, Precinct 43. Sergeant Martin speaking.
Police Department?
Yes.
Oh, I'm sorry. Must have got the wrong number. Don't worry. Everything's okay.
Right, friends, and here's something else to remember. Autolite means spark plugs.
Ignition-engineered spark plugs.
Autolite means batteries.
Stay full batteries.
Autolite means ignition systems.
The lifeline of your car. And now here again is Mr. Edmund O'Brien.
I'd like to say for Anne Blythe and myself that it's been a pleasure to appear on Suspense tonight.
That's right, Eddie. And next week we'll be listening to one of the most famous of all suspense shows, Agnes Moorehead in Sorry, Wrong Number. And that is really tops in.
Suspense.
Anne Blythe appears through the courtesy of Universal International and can now be seen in Mr. Peabody and the Mermaid, released by Universal International. Edmund O'Brien may soon be seen in Warner Brothers' Technicolor production, Fighter Squadron. Tonight's suspense play was written by Bob Shelley and Buckley Angel, with music composed by Lucian Morawek and conducted by Lud Bluskin. The entire production was under the direction of Anton M. Leader. In the coming weeks, Suspense will present such stars as Ronald Coleman, Rosalind Russell, James Cagney, Margaret O'Brien, Claude Rains, and Peter Lorre. Make it a point to listen each Thursday to Suspense, radio's outstanding theater of...
You do understand?
What is your name, ma'am?
Mrs. Stevenson. Mrs. Albert Stevenson.
And your address?
53 North Sutton Place. That's near a bridge. The Queensborough Bridge, you know. And we have a private patrol on our street. And 2nd Avenue is the next street...
And what was that number you were calling?
Murray Hill 40098. But that wasn't the number I overheard. I mean, Murray Hill 40098 is my husband's office. He's working late tonight, and I was trying to reach him to ask him to come home. I'm an invalid, you know, and it's the maid's night off, and I hate to be alone, even though he says I'm perfectly safe as long as I have the telephone right beside my bed.
Well, we'll look into it, Mrs. Stevenson, and see if we can check it with the telephone company.
But the telephone company said they couldn't check the call if the parties had stopped talking. I've already taken care of that.
Oh, you have?
Yes, and personally, I feel you ought to do something far more immediate and drastic than just check the call.
Well, now,
what good
does
checking the call do if they stop talking? By the time you tracked it down, they've already committed the murder.
Well, we'll take care of it, don't you worry.
I'd say the whole thing calls for a search, a complete and thorough search of the whole city. Why, I'm very near the bridge, and I'm not far from 2nd Avenue, and I know I'd feel a whole lot better if you sent around a radio car to this neighborhood at once.
And what makes you think the murder's going to be committed in your neighborhood, ma'am?
Well, I don't know. Only the coincidence is so horrible. 2nd Avenue and the patrol...
Splendid performance. Mr. O'Brien and Miss Blythe will be back in just a moment.
Hello. Where in the world do you get all those Autolite adjectives you throw around?
Ah, those aren't adjectives. Those are facts. And the fact is, I, old Harlow A. for Autolite Wilcox, would give a mountain of money for a meaty, memorable motto to remind America's millions of owners of Autolite-equipped cars to accept no substitute for Autolite parts. For there is no substitute for Autolite parts. So, friends, if you want really reliable electrical parts and service, drive down to your nearest Autolite service station or the dealer who sells your make of car and ask for Autolite original factory parts and service. Tell him I sent you and you'll be taken care of extra pronto.
Arnold, listen.
Autolite, you will find Autolite service stations listed in your classified telephone directory under Automotive Electrical Equipment. And remember, your Autolite electrical system is the lifeline of your car.
Right, friends. And here's something else to remember. Autolite means spark plugs.
Ignition-engineered spark plugs.
Autolite means batteries.
Stay full batteries.
Autolite means ignition systems.
The lifeline of your car.
And now here again is Mr. Edmund O'Brien.
I'd like to say for Ann Blythe and myself that it's been a pleasure to
afford to float around town with no dough. I couldn't afford the chance of ending up in a police lineup, and I certainly couldn't afford to let Pershing get his hooks into me. There was only one other person I knew. I had to risk seeing her. I made my way to the center of town. I went through an arcade into the Broadway building and watched the elevators. She was running the second one from the right. I went up to the top floor on one of the others and got off and waited. When her car registered near the top and nobody was in the hall, I pressed the button to signal.
Down, please.
I've got to talk to you.
You're not a detective. You didn't fool me for long.
I know. I'm sorry about that, but...
Did you kill her?
Why would I want to kill her? I just met her last night in a bar.
But you were in the apartment leaning over.
I know. It looks bad, but you got to believe me.
That's the starter signal. I have to go.
Please, wait. Wait, I haven't got anybody to turn to but you.
They're looking for you.
I know.
The cleaning woman told... I wouldn't want you to think that I'll lose my job.
Please.
The police have been in the building all day. You'll get caught here.
You got to believe me. I didn't kill Brandy.
I've got to go. Please, they'll catch me.
Look. I'm broke. I haven't got a nickel. You gotta help me. I gotta talk to you.
Well, here's a dollar. I'll try to get you more later. I get off.
Lou wants to see you.
Lou? Well, how did he know? Okay, never mind. Where is he?
Not here. He wants to see you across the street in his office.
Oh. Well, let's go. Back in a few minutes, Brad. Have a drink for me.
Sure, Tommy, sure. I'll drink to your health.
How are you, Lou?
Hello, Tommy. Nice to have you back with us.
Nice to be back, Lou. Seems to me you heard pretty fast about me being in town.
You know how it is, Tommy. People drop in here and gossip, and I hear things. Sit down.
Thanks.
Cigarette?
Sure.
Have a nice vacation?
Good enough.
I guess you're just naturally lucky, Tommy. A long vacation and 15 grand to spend. Now me, I didn't get a vacation. I had to work pretty hard, and it cost plenty trying to save Maxie Dunn. And now it's very inconvenient finding someone to take his place.
Well, if you're offering me the job, I'm not interested.
I'm glad to see you haven't changed. But seriously, Tommy, you shouldn't have turned Maxie in.
Oh, I'm sorry I inconvenienced you.
No, it's not only that. You know how it is in this racket. Either you keep rolling sevens and stay on top, or you're on the bottom.
Hey, mister, not that way, the other way.
I knew which way I was going, all right, because in front of that pawn shop, I'd seen a long black car, and sitting behind the wheel was Augie Purge. I spent the next 2 hours in a movie, but I don't know what the picture was about. That pawn ticket kept bothering me. And Eleanor, was she really on my side? Could I depend on her? I decided to go to the Chinese restaurant, all right, but I wouldn't go in. I'd wait a few doors down the street. If she was on the level, she'd come alone. Here I am.
What? You said the restaurant.
Hi. Are you hungry?
No.
Let's walk.
It won't be safe to walk. They're looking for
you. Oh, come on. We can't stand here.
Well, there's the park across the street. It'll be dark soon.
All right.
You look tired.
I am. I'm dead.
Here's a bench. Why don't we sit down?
Okay. No. No, maybe it isn't such a good idea.
Why not?
Well, parks are full of cops snooping around. Maybe we'd better go, huh?
No, let's stay. Here, sit down. Oh, it's nice here. Yeah. Quiet. No elevators, no noise, no people.
Out of here. I herded her out of the apartment. She thought I was taking her down to the station, but I steered her into a chop suey joint. I ordered some tea for her. She looked like she was going to faint. She drank it. Feel better?
Oh, yes. Yes, thank you. I'm sorry to be such a bother.
I guess it was quite a shock.
No. No, not really.
What do you mean?
Brandy was a strange girl, always getting into trouble. Always getting mixed up with the wrong sort of men.
You've known her long?
All my life. We're from the same town. Came here together. Shared the apartment for a while. She worked on the elevator next to mine in the Broadway building, but she hated it. And then one day a photographer rode in her car, and the next day she was a model. That's when she took the name of Brandy. Her real name is Evangeline. She had the face of a Madonna, but...
I know. I met her. Looked like uptown, talked like downtown.
That must be...
Yeah. Now, take it easy. Take it easy. Now, tell me, what was she doing in your apartment today?
She paid half the rent. Well, she said she needed to use the phone for modeling appointments, but I never really believed that. I needed the money. I shouldn't have let her know.
I threw a few things into a bag and headed for Santa Barbara. Seemed like a good place to wait for that opening. Lou would never think of me going to a pleasure resort so near. Anyway, 3 hours after I left Lou's office, I was on a plane bound for Frisco. That's right, San Francisco. When I got there, I rode around for an hour and a half in three different taxis, then caught another plane out for Salt Lake. From there, I swung back to Santa Barbara, checked in at the Swank Ocean Club Hotel. I was pretty sure I'd shaken anybody who may have been watching me. I could count on maybe 2 days before Lou's boys caught up with me, and by that time, I might have a plan. I wandered around on the beach a while, keeping my eyes open for the other reason I had picked Santa Barbara. And then, when I went inside, I saw her, sitting there at the bar. It was the same girl, and she was alone.
Well, I beg your
pardon. Hello there.
Oh, it's you. So you did come to Santa Barbara.
You told me, remember?
I only suggested that...
Yeah, I know, I'm kidding. Mind if I join you?
Please do.
I'm Tommy Cochran.
Tommy Cochran. Oh, hello, Tommy. My name's Helen Ludlow.
Helen, huh? Maybe it's silly, but I was feeling like a kid in the wrong schoolhouse until I saw you sitting there. I know that sounds like the usual...
No, I know what you mean. In fact, I felt the same way.
Good. So now we're both happy. It's about as far as I go, too. I didn't know just where I was going for the first stop. But sometimes it's better if you just play it off the cuff. I guess I was still thinking of the next spin of the wheel as I walked out of the building. I didn't even notice the taxi standing at the curb or the...
Hey, why don't you look where you're going?
I'm sorry. I hope I didn't hurt your traveling case.
No, but I thought you were going to stumble right off the curb.
I guess I was thinking... Say.
What?
You're beautiful.
Well...
I hope you'll live forever.
Thanks, I'll try to.
Yeah, if you find out how, let me know, will you? Where you going?
Huh? Well, now, really?
No, I mean the traveling case there.
Oh, to Santa Barbara.
Santa Barbara, huh? Well, that's not a bad idea. Tell me something. If you had just 1 week, where would you go?
Well, I do have about a week, and I'm still going to Santa Barbara.
All right, honey. Thanks for the idea. Maybe I'll run into you again.
You must...
Hey, that guy bothering you.
Hello, Muggsy. Look, will you be a darling and help me bring these bags up to Lou's office?
I threw a few things into a bag and headed for Santa Barbara. Seemed like a good place to wait for that opening. Lou would never think of me going to a pleasure resort so near. Anyway, 3 hours after I left Lou's office, I was on a plane bound for Frisco.
How do you feel about advances?
I don't mind them at all, so long as you keep them in cash.
I should have walked out then. It was too easy. But I couldn't kick too much. I had 25 of Persian's bucks in my pockets. I guaranteed he'd pick me up in the morning like he said. He was punctual. At 10:30 a.m. sharp, a big black sedan pulled up in front of my rooming house. Persian was all smiles as we drove across town to a small apartment house. He took me up to the third floor to apartment 3B, opened the door, and handed me the key.
Well, this is where you work. Here's the scratch sheets, and there's the phone.
Ah, nice place. By the way, who's Eleanor Grayson?
Why?
Well, that's the name over the bell.
Oh, she lives in this apartment.
She know you're using the place?
You just answered the phone.
Yeah, but suppose she came in?
Look, you get here at 11 and pull out at 4. She'll never see you. That's the way I want it all the time, understand?
But how do
I... She thinks Brenda uses the apartment.
Does she?
You're too nosy, and you talk too much.
Is that advice?
Yeah, let's call it that. The boys have passed the word around about the new phone. You ought to be getting action pretty quick. Write up all the bets you take. I'll call you up from time to time with results. So long.
It was one of those small apartments with a pull-down bed, but it was kind of nice. The sun came in at the windows of the living room. I had it.
You did was dial correctly.
I am sorry. What number are you calling?
Well, can't you for once forget what number I'm calling and do something for me? Now, I want to trace that call. It's my civic duty, and it's your civic duty to trace that call and apprehend those dangerous killers. And if you don't...
I will connect you with the chief operator.
Well, please. This talk can't make anyone understand me.
This is the chief operator.
Chief operator, I want you to trace a call, a telephone call, immediately. I don't know where it came from or who was making it, but it's absolutely necessary that it be tracked down because it was about a murder that someone's planning. A terrible, cold-blooded murder of a poor, innocent woman tonight at 11:15.
I see.
Well, can you trace it for me? Can you track down those men?
I am not certain. It depends.
Depends on what?
It depends on whether the call is still going on.
Well...
If it's a live call, we can trace it on the equipment.
Well,
if it has been disconnected, we cannot.
Disconnected?
If the parties have stopped talking to each other.
Oh, but of course they must have stopped talking to each other by now. That was at least 5 minutes ago, and they didn't sound like the type who would make a long call.
Well, I can try tracing it. May I have your name, please?
Mrs. Stevenson. Mrs. Albert Stevenson. But listen...
And your telephone number, please?
Plaza 32099. But if you go on wasting all this time...
Why do you want this call traced, please?
Why? Oh, well, no reason. I mean, I merely felt very strong.
Who are you? What are you doing here?
How did you get in this apartment?
I live here.
Oh, and you're Eleanor Grayson.
Yes, who are you?
I'll ask the questions. Come on, I'm a detective. Let's get out of here. I herded her out of the apartment. She thought I was taking her down to the station, but I steered her into a chop suey joint. I ordered some tea for her. She looked like she was going to faint. She drank it. Feel better?
Oh, yes. Yes, thank you. I'm sorry to be such a bother.
I guess it was quite a shock.
No. No, not really.
What do you mean?
Brandy was a strange girl, always getting into trouble. Always getting mixed up with the wrong sort of men.
You've known her long?
All my life. We're from the same town. Came here together. Shared the apartment for a while. She worked on the elevator next to mine in the Broadway building, but she hated it. And then one day a photographer rode in her car, and the next day she was a model. That's when she took the name of Brandy. Her real name is Evangeline. She had the face of a Madonna, but...
I know. I met her. Looked like uptown, talked like downtown.
That must be...
Yeah. Now, take it easy. Take it easy. Now, tell me, what was she doing in your apartment today?
She paid...
Personally, I feel you ought to do something far more immediate and drastic than just check the call.
Well, now,
what good
see,
does checking the call do if they stop talking? By the time you tracked it down, they've already committed the murder.
Well, we'll take care of it, don't you worry.
I'd say the whole thing calls for a search. A complete and thorough search of the whole city. Why, I'm very near the bridge, and I'm not far from 2nd Avenue, and I know I'd feel a whole lot better if you sent around a radio car to this neighborhood at once.
And what makes you think the murder's going to be committed in your neighborhood, ma'am?
Well, I don't know. Only the coincidence is so horrible. 2nd Avenue and the patrolman and the bridge.
Well, 2nd Avenue's a very long street, ma'am, and Well, you know how many bridges there are in the city of New York, to mention Brooklyn, Staten Island, Queens, and the Bronx. Now, how do you know there isn't some little house on Staten Island, on some little Second Avenue you've never heard about? Well, how do you know they were even talking about New York at all?
But I heard the call on the New York dialing system.
Well, maybe it was a long-distance call you overheard.
Oh, I...
Telephones are funny things now. Now, look, lady, why don't you look at it this way? Supposing you hadn't broken in on that telephone call. Supposing you'd got your husband the way you always do. You wouldn't be so upset, would you?
Well, I know. I suppose not. Only it sounded so inhuman, so cold-blooded.
A lot of murders are plotted in this city every day, ma'am. We manage to prevent almost all of them. The clue of this kind is so vague, it isn't much...
Suspense. Autolite and its 60,000 dealers and service stations bring you radio's outstanding theater of thrills. Starring tonight, Miss Agnes Moorhead in Anton Leder's production of Lucille Fletcher's famous suspense play, Sorry, Wrong Number. A tale well calculated to keep you in suspense.
Operator, I've been dialing Murray Hill 40098 now for the last three quarters of an hour, and the line is always busy. I don't see how it could be busy that long. Will you try it for me, please?
I will be glad to try that number for you. One moment, please.
I don't see how it could be busy all this time. It's my husband's office. He's working late tonight, and I'm here all alone in the house. My health is very poor, and I've been feeling so nervous all day.
Ringing Murray Hill 4...
Persian was all smiles as we drove across town to a small apartment house. He took me up to the third floor to apartment 3B, opened the door, and handed me the key.
Well, this is where you work. Here's the scratch sheets, and there's the phone.
Ah, nice place. By the way, who's Eleanor Grayson?
Why?
Well, that's the name over the bell.
Oh, she lives in this apartment.
She know you're using the place?
You just answered the phone.
Yeah, but suppose she came in?
Look, you get here at 11 and pull out at 4. She'll never see you. That's the way I want it all the time, understand?
But how do
she
I...
She thinks Brenda uses the apartment.
Does she?
You're too nosy, and you talk too much.
Is that advice?
Yeah, let's call it that. The boys have passed the word around about the new phone. You ought to be getting action pretty quick. Write up all the bets you take. I'll call you up from time to time with results. So long.
It was one of those small apartments with a pull-down bed, but it was kind of nice. The sun came in at the windows of the living room. I had it in mind to explore the kitchen for a cup of coffee, but Persian was right. The word had got around. Hello?
This is J.K. Give me 5 win, 5 show on oatmeal in the third at Pimlico.
5 win, 5 show, oatmeal. Okay, J.K.
By the way, how's the track there?
Let's see. Pimlico? Raining, but still fast.
Okay, thanks.
I was in business. I still had the coffee on my mind.